Who needs the Lord right now? Who needs just a miraculous touch from the Lord right now? Sometimes we just need to call out to Him and just say, Lord, I need You this morning. Lord, I just need a fresh touch this morning. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Lord Jesus, I don't know what I'd do without You, Jesus. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Oh Lord, I praise Your holy name. You're so worthy, oh God. Just have Your way in this place. Hallelujah. If we could all stand together and just believe in our hearts that God's going to do great things in this place this morning. I know that God can do anything. I just got to trust Him and believe that He can. So He will. In Jesus' name. Let's pray together and let's believe God's going to do great things, and then we'll let TJ have His way. In Jesus' name. Lord, we love You. We thank You, Lord Jesus, for what You're doing right now. We ask You, Lord Jesus, to touch every facet of this service, oh God. Lord Jesus, touch every part of ministry, oh God. Touch every soul that walks in this house, oh God. Lord, we believe You're more than able, oh God, to do the miraculous, oh God. We're trusting You, oh God. And we believe, oh God, that You can do anything but fail, oh God. So, Lord Jesus, we come before Your light now, Lord Jesus, believing right now that You're going to do great things, oh God. Touch TJ, oh God, in the ministry of Your word, oh God. We ask You, Lord Jesus, just to have Your way in it. In Jesus' name we pray, and we all say amen.
Praise the Lord. You may be seated. Brother Long and Sister Long have docked successfully in Puerto Rico. And I just pulled up the weather app. There is nothing expected as far as in Indiana's area for around 1 a.m. this coming morning, which is when their flight will land, which means they will have no excuse on why they will not be home. So as of, well, we're going to go ahead and say, as of midnight tonight, if anything pops up, Brother Long is back on duty and you can contact him. I am officially retiring at my post and he will be back to take over. They needed this vacation though, but they will be back. They have, I don't know if you follow him on Facebook, clearly they have enjoyed their time together. But without talking about that, we'll go into that before our service later this morning. We'll jump right into the lesson. Scriptures we're going to turn to today is going to be Revelation 7, 13 through 17. I had that on my phone and then I just turned off my phone. So give me 1 second, let me get that back up. So scriptures, and one of the elders answered, saying unto me, what are these which are arrayed in white robes, and whence came thee? And I said unto him, sir, thou knowest. And he said to me, these are they which came out of the great tribulation, and have washed their robes, and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. Verse 15, therefore are there before the throne of God, and serve him day and night in his temple, and he that sitteth in the throne shall dwell among them. Verse 16, they shall hunger no more, neither thirst any more, neither shall the sunlight on them, nor any heat. And the last verse, verse 17, for the Lamb which is in the midst of the throne shall feed them, and shall lead them unto the living fountains of water, and God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes. Jumping into this, I'll just start from the get-go. I am not a fan of how these lessons are wrote at all. However, my pastor gave me orders, so I'm going to do my very best. I promise you, every time I get up here and tell you this, I am not as good as a teacher as my father. Hopefully one day I will get there, but we are not even close. So bear with me. I promise I will try to speed this up as best I can. The sun's first rays lit the waves as they lapped against the shores at Patmos. He rolled his knees instinctively as his eyes opened. It was the Lord's day. His body shivered at the chill of the damp stone floors, but as he wiped words of worship, John's spirit was transported elsewhere, a voice like a trumpet, visions of seals and angels. It was all beyond the scope of human reasoning. Like a passenger being carried along on a tour, John witnessed the final act of the big story. Amid the litany of lights so specific they could be categorized, counted, and inventoried, and usual expanse broke upon before him. Instantly, he knew the sight was a crowd of people, but his mind reeled at the magnitude of it. all previous attempts at a cataclysm failed here. This great crowd would be impossible to number. As he scanned the enormous crowd, he realized with awe, and the people were from every tribe, people, groups he couldn't even place. The untold millions of faces of every color were yet unified. White robes flowed about them, and they were held palm branches. In unison, they began to shout, "Salvation belongs to our God, who sits in the throne of the Lamb." Revelation 7, verse 10. To give you an idea of where this is all coming from, the book of Revelations was written by the Apostle John. He was, a background, John was imprisoned, poisoned. Everything possibly happened that the world could have thrown at John to kill him, they tried. And unfortunately, well, fortunately for us, unfortunately for them, every one of them failed. So their last step was, well, he was a madman, he was crazy, we're going to exile him. So John, the book of Revelations was written while he was exiled on an island. So all of this is happening to him, and he's literally spending days, and his entire days and hours and minutes, every breath that he has is used in communication with God. There's nobody else to talk to, so he took this opportunity for fasting and prayer, and he used that as an opportunity to get closer to God. At once, all the heavens responded. Angels, elders, and four beasts surrounded the throne, fell to their face and proclaimed, "Amen, blessing and glory and wisdom, thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to our God forever and ever. Amen." Revelation chapter 7, verse 12. As John peered into the land where time is no more, an elder pushed near and turned up to him with a question. "Who are these arrayed in white robes, and where did they come from?" That's Revelation chapter 7, verse 13. All this is happening as a communication. A lot of people that study the Bible think that John is going mad. And at this point, he's getting visions from God. He's getting visions about the book of Revelations. He's seen the end time before it ever was, millions of years before it was going to happen. John's seen it. John took in the scene and shook his head, pondering the question, sensing the sovereignty of the moment. He offered, "Sir, you know." The elder nodded and proclaimed, "These are the ones who came out of the great tribulation and washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb." John surveyed the immersion crowd as the elder swept his hand across the stage and continued, "Therefore, they are before the throne of God and serve him that day and night in his temple." I'm going to kind of jump ahead because this is literally from here on, we're just reading the scriptures. But the foundation of this entire lesson is based on the fact that John saw the revelation before it really happened, because he started his walk, he was forced into his walk by exile. So through this, God gave John all these visions because of his communication, his walk with God. Our story concludes this week on a stage so grand, it sweeps all the way around the globe. For as news of the resurrected God begins to spread, ramifications rocked the very essence of what made the world go round. So much of that, the spectators of the big story would say that the cast that they turned the world upside down. The grand story carried a surprise twist. The audience had thought when the hero was executed, the story was over, like so many other Greek tragedies. But this was no ordinary story. The writer upset the formula, broke all the unwritten rules of the storyteller, and unveiled the surprising plot twist of the hero, emerging victorious from the grave, more powerful than death itself. Surely now the curtain would fall, the narrator would announce the end. No such thing happened. The drama shifted in Jesus' inner circle as they traveled across the world stage to proclaim this very story. The story took them to an upper room the day of the Pentecost. As they prayed there and the drama peaked out again, the images of fire appeared over each of them. And as the Spirit of the living God fell upon them and they filled their hearts, the audience watches and as extra crowd the stage. Visitors from around the world who heard the native language being spoken as a sign of the Holy Ghost was covenanting with people from every walk of life. God's Spirit was poured out in the New Testament for all people. So this story takes us from Revelation, then jumps way back to the beginning when God was first born, taking us from then into the days of to his crucifixion. From then it goes back into the days of Pentecost. Jesus being crucified, let me think about how I want to explain this a little better. Going back to the original tabernacle, when sins were committed and were needed to be forgiven, you had to bring a perfect, spotless animal. the wealthier families could afford a spotless lamb, and that was the thing to do. However, the poor families, the everyday family, didn't have the money or the ability to give up a spotless lamb. So they would use a perfect pigeon at the time, or a perfect dove. That would be their sacrifice. The reason God died on the cross so that sacrifice was no longer given. The ultimate lamb was slain for our sins. So that instead of having to go to a high priest for that high priest to have to slay a lamb for you and pray over you and everything like that, you could go to him directly. That's the big difference between the Pentecostal way of forgiveness and a lot of other religions. Catholicism has a way of confession. You go to the priest and the priest tells you 3 Hail Marys, $100, and hey, you're good to go. Pentecost is the day of Pentecost was the start of us being able to have a direct line to our Savior. The big question of all this, though, the thing that ties it all together is, have you received the Holy Ghost? If so, what was your experience like? Jumping back to the story, all the house lights burst onto the signal. A new day as the believers began to go around the world with the message of salvation and eternal life through Jesus. But again, tragedy and drama strikes as the villain once again fights back. Opponents to the message of the story spring up, wielding politics, power, and the reign of physical terror as they attempt to demonstrate the cast and shut the mouths of the storyteller. In ghastly scenes that drive the audience members to shield their eyes against the violence, cast members are portrayed as they're getting slaughtered. After the day of Pentecost is when it really began, all the horror stories, the Colosseum of slaying Christians, feeding them to the lions. This is when that all really started. The day of Pentecost was upon us, and it wasn't so much the world being scared. The devil knew that, unfortunately, the one key that he had holding us had been taken from him when Jesus went and took the keys of life from him. So the only power that he technically had was taken from him. So now he uses the one thing that he could always have, and he to this day can throw at us. He can still throw sin our way. So he threw sin and fear into the hearts of everybody to try to destroy this religion before it even got up and started. What hardships have you faced since you started following God? Now, granted, I pray and hope none of you have been attacked because of your faith, but not to that extreme, but what hardships have you faced in an everyday life? Think of those hardships as I continue this story. And Jesus came and spoke to them, saying, "All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them and observing all things that I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age." Amen. Matthew chapter 28, verse 18-20. We join the story of the New Testament. While we may not suffer the same physical fates, we are likewise on a journey to share the story with others and be who King Jesus calls us to be. While centuries separate us, we will one day join them. All of us have a destination, a greater hope. At this point, the actors freeze in their place on the stage as the audience takes in the scope of Jesus' story spreading around the world. Their narrators begin to explain the behind-the-scenes directions from the author. All of the scenes combine to form an overarching story from creation to God's present covenant. As we step back and look at the whole scripture, we can learn truth about God from the big story. The big story shows us that God is a sovereign creator and ruler. The key word, a sovereign creator. That's the main thing we have to focus on this. He's not just our ruler and a boss. You have to look at it as he created you for a purpose. He created us for that relationship. It's corny, but it's true. God was literally bored of sitting there talking to the angels. So he created us so that he could have people to communicate with. That's what our purpose was and still is. Above the stage and except of his creation of stars, planets, and humans were plays in dramatic fashion. The narrator reads from the story to remind us that it all began with a sovereign plan of God. "For by him all things are created that are in heaven and that are on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or denominations or principles or powers. All things were created through him and for him." How are you trusted in the sovereignty of God's will for your life? How have you taken a step in and decided God's purposeful will for your entire life? That's the main question that's really going to kind of drive this as I'm transitioning here. What have you decided is going to be your purpose in your walk with God? What's your main goal? The big story shows us that God loves humanity and reveals himself to us, inviting us to start our relationship. At the end of the day, that's the cut and dry of all of this, is that God is pushing us to start a relationship with him. Forget everything else that you've really started off and said, hey, this is the goal you have to get to. This is where you have to start. This is a relationship, point blank. Perfect example. Before Amy even decided to date me, forget marry me, forget that. Before she would date me, the first time I texted her was in August. And good and well, I knew I had a plan in mind. I was like, this won't take me long. We'll be in a date in October at the latest. Worst comes to worst, the Marine Corps ball is coming up in November. No woman in their right mind will say no to a Marine in his dress blues. That was my plan of thought. I said, no way. I got this. She's seen me in my dress blues before to work. So my plan was, I asked her out in September. She said, nope, not going to happen. Not interested. And I said, okay, sure you're not. Tried again in October, and she shot me down even quicker that time and said, look, I really don't like you. I don't want to go on a date with you. It's not happening. And I said, well, fine then. So I threw out the Marine Corps ball coming up, and I don't have a date. And I've already bought a ticket, and I really want you to go with me. And she said, okay, I'll think about it. And I said, yeah, sure you will. I thought in the back of my mind, this relationship had started. And I was set in stone. I was like, this is going to happen. She's going to drive all the way down to Evansville. We'll ride all the way down to Evansville with me. We're going to go to the Marine Corps ball, come back, and boom, relationship kickstart. And it was like a day later, I got the answer. No, I'm not going with you. And I sat there and I thought, hang on now, let's really think about this. I said, I've already spent the $75 on the ticket for you. And she said, yeah, I don't want to go. And I said, I'll be in my dress blues. I said, I'll be in my Marine uniform. She said, I don't want to go. So at that point, I thought, all right, well, fine, I don't want to take you anyways. Our relationship started extremely rough. In fact, you can ask Kelsey and Carly. The exact words were annoying and childish, is how she described me. Annoying and childish. And that's how our relationship started. And to this day, anytime she tries to even act mad at me, I said, oh, I'm sorry. Am I being annoying and childish? And typically, that's how our arguments normally end. But the fact is, we had to start our relationship somewhere. And granted, now it's grown into this wonderful marriage where she bosses me around. But at the end of the day, our relationship had to start somewhere. And that was my main goal for this, for the entire part, was I had no clue whether I was going to marry Amy. I had no clue whether our one date would turn into two or whatever. But my main goal was to start a relationship. And that's our main goal here. How have you accepted God's invitation to relationship with him? Did you pull the Amy route and tell him absolutely no, there's no chance, not even if hell froze over? Or have you actually walked into that relationship with an open mind? It's important that when you start a relationship, no matter what it is, whether it's a new job, whether it's a new friendship, you have to walk into it with an open mind. If you meet somebody and right at the get-go, your first impression is they're stuck up, annoying, childish, anything like that, you have no idea what it will turn out to, because you've had it set in your mind that this relationship is not going to work. Looking at us, you would think there's no way in the world. I'm 6 feet tall, 212 pounds. She's 5 feet tall. She says she's 4'11 and a half. She's 5 feet tall. We round up in the Long family. 5 feet tall and weighs soaking wet with a bunch of clothes on, 105, 110 pounds. So looking at us, no, there's a foot difference and I weigh twice what she does. So there's no way that would work out. She is much quieter, laid back. I am loud, annoying, childish. That's my personality. Completely different. She doesn't play sports at all. She can watch football. She kind of can watch basketball now that I make her. But no way in the world. Me personally, Brother Harper, ain't nothing better than going to watch Pacers play. I mean, only thing better is watching Kentucky getting beat. But at the end of the day, completely separate. she's from the south, I'm from the north. She won't go hunting and couldn't shoot a deer. I would have killed anything to get a deer this year. And unfortunately, I didn't get one. Me, if my dad doesn't get a deer, I rub it in his face. I'm like, wow, you sat in the woods and didn't see a thing. I came home every weekend without a deer. And she said, it's okay, you'll get one next time. Complete opposites. And at the beginning of our relationship, she had said in her mind, I was annoying and childish. If she would have kept it, who knows where I would be now? But she came into the relationship with an open mind. And that's what we have to do, even with our relationship with God. You're set that you want a relationship with God. That's great. But are you coming in with an open mind, expecting to give the time, the energy, the communication, the time to fast? Are you expecting to give all that? What are you doing to nurture that relationship? Just because that relationship has started, just because Amy finally, on January 12th, decided to go to Beef and Boards with me, does not mean that is where, hey, I'm golden, I can coast now. I don't even want to know how much I spent in flowers the first 3 months we were dating. But I had to nurture that relationship. Mainly it was a pride thing. Because I had chased her for 6 months, I was set in stone, this is going to work. So you have to, what have you been doing to nurture the relationship? Coming to church on Thursday and Sundays is not enough to nurture that relationship. Taking Amy out once a week was not enough to nurture that relationship to where I wanted it to eventually go. So you have to put in time, meaning you have to put in time in prayer. Whether you come to the church and pray or whether you do it yourself, you have to put time into fasting like we do on Wednesdays. The normal Thursdays and Sundays, that's your normal time together. As a married couple, we don't go to sleep. Amy's a cuddler. She's not in here, so I can say this. She will not go to sleep if I don't at least cuddle with her for 10 minutes every night. She won't. She has woken me up, and she's woken me up and said, we didn't cuddle. I'm like, it's 1 in the morning. I know we didn't. I'm asleep. But that's how Amy works. She has to. I can't tell you why. Me personally, I don't go to sleep unless I watch an episode of The Big Bang Theory. That's just what I do. So she'll sit there and be like, well, let's watch Gilmore Girls. And I'm like, okay, we'll watch your normal show, whatever. So she'll watch an episode, and they're like, all right, I'm ready to go to bed. I was like, all right, I'll be in there 30 minutes. And I watch an episode of The Big Bang Theory, and then I'm like, all right, I'm ready to go to bed. But we operate differently. So our relationship, we found the kinks and found things that we have to do and how we normally run. You have to find what works for you. But what's most importantly, what nurtures the relationship. If it's not a help towards it and it hinders your relationship with God, it's probably something that's not the best thing to do. For instance, I like going to Pacers games. Amy's annoyed going to Pacers games. We don't go to Pacers games. I can watch them just fine from the comfort of my couch. She can watch her Netflix show on her phone. It works better that way. We're both happy. So therefore, we've compromised. Unfortunately, with your walk with God, there's not really going to be much compromising. Unfortunately, we have a guideline that we need to follow. So you have to compromise what you want. We can't take the word of God and compromise it into fitting what we want. This relationship builds on, it's, don't look at the Bible as a set of rules. Look at it more as a set of guidelines. We're giving you a free ticket, a pathway. We have given you the instruction manual. God has given us the instruction manual of how to have eternal life. So we are using that, and that's what we're going to use to nurture our relationship. Next, the big story reveals God as a redeemer, intent for restoring relationship with fallen humanity. God made us and loved us, but he loves us too much to watch from afar without saving us from our own mistakes. Throughout every scene of every act, the hero has been working to draw us to him, provide a way for us to be redeemed and brought into the standing with him. Do you invite God to actively work in your life, seeking him daily and purifying yourself? I use that very loosely. Obviously, you don't have to pray before you tie your shoe. Please tie your shoe so you don't trip. Before you make a life decision, do you go to somebody to consult them? Perfect example, Tim had to stay here on Thursday because Amber and Victor wanted to talk to him about finances. So Tim sat here until everybody else was gone, and I literally pulled a Brother Hunt and turned the lights off, kind of giving a hint, and Victor didn't receive that hint. He kept talking. So they took that as an opportunity, and they found guidance. anything you do in life, any major step you take in life, you should consult God for. Yes. Perfect example. I have no problem with my current job. I like my current job. However, an opportunity has come to me that is a better job. Me personally, I thought, well, dear Lord, it's more money. What's to pray about? However, before I sent that application, Amy asked me out of the blue. She said, have you prayed about it? And I was like, shoot, no, it's more money. What's to pray about? And she said, well, the hours are going to be a little different. You're going to have a tough time getting here and there. So before we did anything, before I hit the submit button, we sat there and prayed about it. We thought about what it was best for us, money-wise. Obviously played a huge role in it. But we thought about what was best, not just for our relationship, but how it was going to affect our relationship and church-wise. Were we going to get taken out from things because of this new job? At the end of the day, we both felt like we've gotten the same answer, and we went ahead and hit the submit button. I was sitting there praying not only that I got to hit the submit button, God, and make sure this was the right move, but I was praying, Lord, please give her the same answer. It's a nice bonus for me. It's a nice opportunity for me. But before we even thought about it, we went and consulted with God. I haven't consulted with my pastor about it. I didn't consult Tim about it. I'm pretty sure if I would have told Tim about it, he said, hey, that's a great opportunity. You should take it. But the point I'm trying to get to is, are you seeking in a daily walk with him an opportunity to grow with him? Meaning before you take an opportunity anywhere, before you take a chance on something, are you consulting with God to make sure that that's what he has planned for your life? Because by all means, the devil understands, I guarantee you the devil knows the best way to my heart is to throw a bunch of money in my face. And by all means, I would take a job if I thought, man, that's a lot more money. I can, because I'll weigh it more on, well, I can still make it to church just on time if I get there and we close right at that right time. I can make it just on time. And that's a huge weakness of mine. Huge. Because I'll calculate it all in my head and I won't jump straight into prayer. And another bonus of Mary and Amy, she thinks right away, well, you should pray about it. The money will be nice. Yeah, the hours will be a little different. We'll get used to them. But she jumped straight to prayer. And that's the important thing. Anytime something comes up, you need to ask yourself, is this going to benefit my walk with God? Finally, the big story shows that God uses redeemed humanity in his mission to reach others and rule and reign with him in eternity. This is really God's last step in the whole story. He uses us as a perfect picture of what our end goal can be, what he wants us to be. We are an example, and we have to live that way. We have to portray that way. I am hot-headed more than anybody here. I get a solid dose from the long side and then an even solid dose from the hunt side. I'm hot-headed. I lose my temper constantly. However, we have to portray that we are not correct or living correct, but we have to portray God's light in us everywhere we go. And that's the tough part, because my grandma is right there in the fourth row. I'm hot-headed, and I will say whatever comes to mind when I get hot-headed, period. That's the end of it. And there have been multiple times where when I lived at home, she said, now, is that what God would say? Or she said, is that what God wanted you to say? And it'd be the most annoying thing in the world. But that's what we have to think of. Anytime we do an action, God is using us, whether you believe it or not or whether you like it or not, God is going to use you to reach this world. One way or the other, whether you want to run from it or not, God's going to use you to reach this world. Because no matter how you twist your life, it's always shown that if you stay in church, naturally blessings come to you and all these wonderful things happen to you because God is in your life. If you leave the church, you can say, well, I'm still doing okay, I'm still doing all right. But in the back of your mind, you can always ask the question, where would I be though if I would have stayed in church? Yeah, maybe you wouldn't be able to work on Sundays, okay. That would be tough. Thursday nights, I'd have to be off by 7:30. But you're not getting the blessings that God gives to you by coming to these services, by having that relationship. So God's going to use you, whether you even acknowledge it or not. You're going to be used to reach the lost. How are you joined in the mission with the body of Christ to participate in the ministries of reconciliation? Scrub that question and let's re-ask it. What are you doing in the church? And we are at a perfect size. I don't like mega churches. I just don't. I don't like It would be awesome to pastor one day 8,000, 9,000 people. It would be an amazing thing to do. However, a church of 120 to 150, there's really not room for a pew potato. Unfortunately, with the massive square footage that we have under roof here, there's just not room for a pew potato. By all means, your first few months, you're going to take time of adjusting and getting into the rule. However, once you're in, we're grabbing hold and we're setting hook and you're with us. We're going to have to use you. It's not, Brother Harper hasn't been here too long and Brother Long's gone. Hey, he's preaching twice in a row. As soon as we get you here, we're setting hook. And if you're already saved, you don't even get the first Sunday off. So the main question is, what are you doing in the church to better your relationship? Because once you get that relationship set in stone as far as prayer, fasting, then comes into how are you being a light to the world. After you are witnessing and being a light to the world, then comes into step, hey, what are you doing in the church? That's the big thing of actually getting stuck here. Once you're used here, you think in your mind, well, I can't really not go to church because they're expecting me to be here. Believe it or not, being a greeter, being an usher, Brother Long uses that as for you to say, man, I really can't afford not to be here. He does it on purpose. He does it on purpose. Because then he knows good and well he's counting on you. And then it's not you, because everybody feels bad. Oh, I didn't make it to church. I feel a little bad. You don't get that immediate reaction. God's not going to call you on Monday morning and say, hey, we were kind of short-staffed because you weren't there. Brother Long will call you on Monday morning and say, hey, we were short-staffed. If Brother Fuller was not here, I do not know what I would do when Brother Long leaves. Because I have no idea where their offering pans are. I have no idea how to unlock all of these doors. So if Brother Fuller, and more importantly, if Sister Barb wasn't here, I don't even know the password to the computer at the greeting stand. So if two people decided not to show up today, we would be without offering pans, and there'd be nobody to be able to log into the greeter post because I have no idea those passwords. I don't know if you've shared it with anybody. I know I don't have it. So this is all set in stone as far as we get people involved in church so that they get set here, so that they feel wanted. If people are feeling wanted, then they're more likely to continue to come back. That's why it's important that we greet people when they walk in. This is all part of discipleship here. I've basically given you Brother Long's blueprint of how you're all eventually going to be used. So if you're not being used on a daily basis, keep showing up. Don't worry. You'll get there. This is the blueprint that we've used for since I can remember, and it's successful. We went out to lunch last Sunday, Brother Harp. Me, Amy, and the Harpers went out, and we sat down and we counted. If we would have kept everybody, all the preachers that Brother Long is mentored, if we would have kept everybody, and let's just say they witnessed to most of the people, not all of them, if they witnessed to most of the people that they currently pastor, there's not enough land here to build the sanctuary we would need to house them all. We would be well over 1,200 people as a church if we kept everybody. So Brother Long sees his calling as he's meant to mentor people. That's his calling, and that's what he said in. So he's accepted that calling. He knows good and well. He's never going to see a 1,000-person church, and he's perfectly okay with that. That's his calling. His goal is mentor people. Let me start more churches to reach more people. That's his. I'm asking you now, though, what's your? What do you see yourself? As much as in a career set point, everybody asks you, well, where do you see yourself in 10 years? You have to ask yourself, where do you see yourself next year in church? If you just continue to come to church and say, well, my goal is I'm just going to sit on the pew and I'll be happy here and I'm okay with that. That's not a good enough goal. Just like where you currently are at work, you don't want to be at that same position next year, 2 years, 3 years down the road. You want to continue to grow and you want to continue to succeed. That needs to be your passion here in church and here with God. The same relationship, being able to have a normal conversation without speaking in tongues when you talk to God, that shouldn't be a normal for you. That shouldn't be what you're accepted with. You should literally feel his presence and his spirit every time you pray with him. Every single time. That should be your goal. That should be how you participate, how you start participating in ministries. all these truths play out, not in the simple start to finish children's story, but in the grand scheme of humanity. For not only God without beginning or end, but he desires to command with us eternally, and his grand story, the grand story of his master plan for all humanity beyond the bounds of time. Our natural eyes gravitate to the cares around us, and we may fail to recognize God's big story. However, he has put eternity in our hearts. God desires eternal life for us, eternal life with him. That's his goal. As much as we want to see God, he wants to see us eternally even more. So as much as we put into this, God is pouring more into you than you can really give to him. We have plenty of time here praying and fasting. We give all that time. I promise you, God is watching you more and giving more time to you than you could possibly give to him. How a normal relationship is going to work is, it has to be a give and take. You should put in as much time as God puts into you. So with that being said, if God is always giving more time, you should always strive to give God more opportunity to work in your life. That's why I said earlier, it's important that any big life goal you take, you should ask God. You should counsel with God. That's why when you take those steps, you should take that opportunity to grow your relationship with him. God gave John a vision of the eternal hope to come in Revelation. John painted a picture of eternal rest in heaven. John saw the immeasurable host of people from every nationality who bowed before the throne in Revelation chapter 7, verse 13 through 14. Those believers John saw entering their reward had come through tribulation. However, they stood spotless before the throne because they were washed in the blood of the Lamb. The rewarded John described is a promise that gives Christians of all ages hope. How are you actually looking for the return of Jesus Christ? Are we actively seeking that? Are we actively preparing ourselves for that day, for that when God comes back? Are we preparing ourselves, or are we saying mentally, he's not coming back today, I got tomorrow, I'm good? We need to, as bad as it sounds, we need to prepare that we are not promised tomorrow. And we need to prepare our walk with God in that way. How can you comfort others with this hope? Do not walk up to somebody and tell them, God's coming back tomorrow and you're going to hell. That's not a good way at all. Do not walk up to somebody and start your ministry walk with that. Start it like a normal relationship. It's not successful anywhere you go to start a relationship off the bat. You can't walk up to a girl and kiss her right on the mouth. It's just not going to work, and it's not going to end well for you. You just can't do it. Even when you go to meet a girl for the first time, there's courtships with them. So you have to do that exact same thing when you're bringing somebody into this. You're going to have to start off slow, and there are going to be questions. It's just like raising a child. Thankfully, we have not blessed the land here with little TJs yet. I'm trying to hold Amy off, not for my satisfaction and for my health, for your health. I am trying to hold her off as much as I can from little TJs running around here. When that happens, we'll need more offerings and tithe to repair what little TJs will do around here. But you have to bring somebody into the church that exact same way. Children, when they first come out, don't know right from wrong. So we can't punish them and start whipping them right from the get-go. It's not something that's going to happen. You have to slowly bring them into this. Slowly nurture them into all this. Because if we go instantly into the harsh truth about all this and say, well, you're doing that, that's fine. Tomorrow, God's going to come back and you're going to hell. You're going to scare people away. Plain and simple. There's no way to sugarcoat it or anything like that. You're going to scare people away. That's why with fasting, Brother Balt, great example. You have to nurture your body into doing an extended fast. You can't just walk out of here and say, I'm going to fast for 40 days. Your body's not going to adjust to that correctly. You have to get the toxins out of it slowly. It takes, to do an extended fast, it's going to take you 4 to 5 days to get all the toxins out of your body. You're going to have to do that same thing. Bringing somebody new into the church, it's not realistic to think that in 4 or 5 days or even in one service, they can just toss everything to the side. It's going to take 4 or 5 months, even longer. But it's important for us as disciples to nurture them through that step. God's plan, Genesis doesn't start with, God created the earth and everything in it. Chapter 1. Chapter 2, God came back and died on the cross. Chapter 3, God came back. That's not how the story goes. There's books upon books, chapters upon chapters of a guideline for us. We have to use that guideline. Just like it took God thousands of years to not just create the world, but to create it, let mankind grow, let the relationship grow. And then he came back. And then it took a lifetime for him teaching and showing it disciples. And then after that, he died on a cross and came back. And then the New Testament started. So there was still more to be learned after that. And we're still learning today. So it's not like we can expect somebody to jump in and start right where we are. That's not realistic. I don't expect somebody to walk into the door and then next Sunday them come up and fill in for Brother Long teaching this class. Perfect example. I've been preaching 5-6 years. I don't know how long Brother Harper's been preaching. There's a big difference there. And as far as quality, forget quantity and how long I can go and how long he can go. There's a huge difference in quality. Because Brother Harper's done this longer. He's studied longer. He's walked with God longer. So therefore, he has the ability to be able to find topics that I would never think of. I never in my wildest dreams, reading the scriptures that he read, would I have pulled that scripture out and pulled that sermon out of there. No way in the world. I'll sit there and I'll go and talk to my dad and he'll be like, oh, look at this. And he'll read a scripture and say, here's where I could go with this. And I sit there and think, that has absolutely nothing to do with that scripture. And he'll sit there and talk to me for 20 minutes and reeling it all in. Never would I have thought of that. Brother Long's a great pastor. He's done this for over north of 20 years. It's not realistic for me to think on the first day that he's gone in the week that I cover for him that I'm just as good as a pastor. It's not realistic. It takes time to learn. It's going to take time for people to learn. The point of being a disciple is to slowly nurture people into this. You're going to have to take the time. I feel like every time I teach one of his lessons, I go back to the same thing. It takes time. But at the end of the day, that's what it's going to require. It's going to take your time. It's going to take your effort. In Brother Long's case, it's going to take your hair. You're going to pull your hair out. That's all part of your walk with God. Your purpose was not just to sit here and go through the motions with us. Your purpose was to come in, get set in God's word. Once you're set in God's word, to want more. After you want more and you have begged Brother Long to put you in a ministry, we set you in a ministry and you feel wanted and feel like you want to be back here and this is home to you. After that, then is where you can come up and say, Brother Long, I think I want to start a church somewhere. Then you start this process all over again. But instead of you being the person that is getting put through all this, now you're putting tens, hundreds of people more through this exact same process. The wall of China wasn't built in a day. You can't expect people to change in a day. Amy makes great gumbo. It takes her 4 hours to make gumbo. It takes time. Anything you want is worth waiting for. You want to live eternally. It's going to take the time to adjust to this. Brother Long, myself, Brother Harper, Brother Kiner, Brother Victor, your entire ministry staff doesn't expect you to flip a switch instantly. We fully expect and are aware that you're going to have downfalls. Brother Long sits there, and when you call him because something has happened bad in your life or you have done something that you know is wrong, he may sit there and lecture you. Yes, yes, he does. I've heard them all, I promise. I haven't heard him talking to you. He's given all those speeches to me. We expect that. God expects those downfalls. It's because God is forgiving and his grace that those downfalls, stray from them as best you can. Don't beat yourself up because you've had a downfall. Brother Long expects them. God is going to forgive you for them. Take from that and learn from it. Learn from your mistakes. Stand up and continue on that path. I'm not saying go out and do wrong and then come back and repent and you're all good. No, learn from your mistakes. And then once you become and ready to disciple somebody, that becomes your testimony. And now you have a testimony saying, I know where you're at because God did this with me and look where I am now. Your testimony is your sales pitch. And that's what we need to grow on. Remember your walk with God. Remember the steps and the guidelines. I've gone over by 5 minutes, so I am sorry about that. I promise Brother Long will be back next Sunday, and you won't have to listen to me teach anymore until he decides to go on another vacation in a week or two. But we're going to go ahead and split for our break. Please be back in the sanctuary at 11 o'clock for our morning worship service. The main thing to take away from this lesson is there's a guideline. Use scripture. Grow your relationship. Anytime you take a major step with God or a major step in your life, consult God for that. Brother Long will not get annoyed. If you don't, you're not comfortable calling Brother Long, please don't call me with life decisions. Call Brother Harper or Victor. They've lived a little bit longer. Call them and ask them about it. If it's financial, we have people here that can help with that and that are going to give you the correct financial answer, and then they're also going to give you a God answer. And that's what it really comes down to. Use the Bible as the guidelines and an instruction book for your walk with God. Please be back here at 11 o'clock. We'll start our morning worship, and we'll actually have some church. Amen?